Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God.
Then believed they his words. They sang his praise. They soon forget his works. It's amazing. They're singing his praise. They're having a spell, having a time of it. And then what? They soon forget his works again. They waited not for his counsel, but lusted exceedingly in the wilderness and tempted God in the desert. And he gave them their request, but sent leanness into their soul. Father, we ask. Amidst all of the buffoonery of mankind, God treats us well. We sin. We're constantly disappointing him. And then He does something great and marvelous for us, and we rejoice in it for a spell, and then we forget all about it, and go right back to our old ways again. And through all of that, people ask for things, and God gives it to them. But sometimes, you know, folks, you can have a hissy fit in your Christian life, and you can demand things from God, and you can say, I'm not going to do another thing, or you'll say something like, God, if you do this, then I'll do this and this and this and this. But it says here in verse number 15, it says, and he gave them their request. Gave it to them. But sent leanness into their soul. Gave them what they wanted, but they received something that they didn't want. I'll preach on that thought here tonight. You asked for it. You asked for it. Israel had been blessed of God. There's no doubt about that. You can see that all through the Old Testament. God provided water. God provided manna. Yet they still were not satisfied. The more God gives us, the more unthankful we tend to be. No wonder God had to say, be ye thankful. Because we tend not to be. They wanted flesh. Now, you know, you always have to keep this in mind, that those days are not these days. Now, why, if you got flesh today, if you got yourself a bird, you got yourself a cow, or a hog, we can take it home, and we can take the portion that we're going to eat tonight, pop it in the refrigerator, cook it tonight. All the extra that we're going to eat next week and next month, we can put in the freezer. But when you're out in the desert, in the wilderness, and you're asking for flesh, you better be able to eat it quickly, or it's going to spoil. Matter of fact, God made manna that way. He said, you just give us this day our daily bread. Oh, yeah, yeah. See, God never said that he was going to stock us up. I'll tell you one thing that's probably not going to be in heaven. Freezers. God said, no, freezers are for people that want to stock up. You come to me for your daily provisions. Anyway, Philippians 3, verse 17 to 19 says, brethren, be followers together of me and mark them which walk so as ye have us for an ensample. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you, even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. They just care about earthly things. They care about materialism. That's all they care about. Their God is their belly. But like a spoiled child, you know, I want it now. I hear that in the store. I chuckle when I hear children going like that. Because I always like to see what the response of the parents are going to be. I know how my parents would have responded. I'm just curious today how many times parents acquiesce and just give it to them, you know. If I give you this, do you promise to not? yeah, okay, whatever. Of course. Like a spoiled child. God didn't give them flesh in the wilderness because he knew that, that they could survive just well on water and manna. But you know what they did? They murmured and they complained and they stomped their feet and they stiffened their neck and they did all of those things and they got mad at God. God said, yeah, you want flesh? I'll give you flesh. And you know how the Bible describes it? They had flesh until it was coming out their nostrils. See, he gave them what they wanted, gave them their desire, but sent leanness into their soul, gave them something they didn't want. And what could they say at that point? God would just simply say, you asked for it. See, if you just trust me, God would always say to us, if you just trust me, you'll get what you get, when you get it, when you need it. My God shall supply all your need, according to him. God supplies it. We don't demand it. I know most of us here tonight actually believe that we know what's best for us. We know what we need. We know when we need it. And we just want God to deliver. He's like the delivery guy. He's an FTD florist. You know, we just dial him up and tell him to deliver. Well, God has a little more interest in our well-being than that. Sometimes he knows now is not the right time. And we ought to wait on the Lord for those things. James 4 and verse number 3 says, ye ask and receive not. Why? You're asking God for something and you don't get it. Why? God says, I don't want to give this to you now. Maybe you're asking, well, he goes on to say, because you ask amiss, that you may consume it upon your lusts. Most people that are begging and pleading God for something is because they want something. Not that they need something. I honestly believe that if we would beg God for something for somebody else, we'd probably see those things come really quickly. But that's not most of the stuff we're asking for. Most of the things we're asking for is for ourselves. We can't even start by saying, thank you, Lord. We start off by saying, and give me this, and give me that, and give me that, and by the way, all right, thanks. Sometimes God will give you what your flesh wants, but will send along the leanness to your soul. Because when we're satisfying the flesh, we're robbing the soul and the spirit of what they want, what they need. We spend too much time silencing the soul and spirit, and we cave in to the flesh. How many times can you relate to it? Have you ever related to, you got something and then it either wasn't what you thought it was, or, you know, just wasn't what you anticipated. Or along with it, you received all kinds of heartache. I've known of people that received a certain thing and it actually destroyed their homes. I never expected that this was going to happen. God did. But you begged and pleaded for it. Jesus said in Matthew 16 and verse 26, for what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? See, the barter system doesn't work with God. We can't say, God, let me give up some spiritual things as long as you give me the material things. God says, well, I don't know about that, though. See, meat was a poison to them in the wilderness. I mean, if they weren't prepared right then and there to stop and cook and eat, then this thing was probably going to spoil. Have you ever seen over in the foreign countries? Man, that's nasty. They go in the market, people eat that stuff. No wonder they pray over meals. We spend most of our time in this country praying over a meal because we're thankful for it. In those countries, they pray and say, God, please don't let me die from eating this stuff. You ever seen it? You ever seen like this chicken strung up? The flies are all over it. It's been hanging up there all day long, waiting for someone to come down and cut it. Yeah, you want this one? No, I want the one that's packaged up. It says Purdue on it. You know, it's been sitting in the freezer. You know, race home with it right away. Don't let it sit in your car. They're out in the wilderness. They're in the desert. Are you ever mindful of that? I've got groceries in the car. Oh, I know, we only get concerned about the ice cream melting. But, you know, if you've got meat in the trunk of your car on a hot summer day, are you going to spend the whole day just driving around town? No, you're mindful that you're going to get home, you're going to put this in the refrigerator or put it in the freezer. God knew these people don't need meat right now. See, God determines what a blessing is to us. We don't. We don't. In 1 Corinthians 10, verse 9 to 11, the Bible says, "Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted." Again, referring back to this time back in the Old Testament. "And were destroyed of serpents. Neither murmur ye, as some of them also murmured, and were destroyed of the destroyer. Now all of these happened unto them for ensamples." Ensamples for who? Us. "And they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come." You know, the Bible still says in Psalms 18 and verse number 30, "As for God, his way is perfect." His way is perfect. You asked for it. Let me give you some examples of that here tonight. Look in Genesis chapter number 3 for a second, and verse number 2. "And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, Ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die." Boy, talk about messed up. "And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat." Guess what, Eve, honey? You asked for it. You got it. Eve wanted to be godlike. Ooh, that sounds good. You mean to tell me God's holding out on us? He knows that we'll be just like him? Well, we better eat of that. She got what she wanted, didn't she? But God also sent leanness unto her soul. And guess what? The devil said, "Thou shalt not surely die," but she most certainly did. And she took somebody with her. About the time you think that it doesn't really matter, you'll work your way out of it, Eve couldn't work her way out of this. She asked for something, she got it, and she paid the consequences for it. Look over in Genesis chapter 13. Genesis chapter 13. We're just going to look at a few instances where people wanted something and they got it. And then I'm going to go out on a limb. I didn't have the opportunity to have a little one-on-one with Eve and say, you know, what do you think? You want to change that now? If you had it all to do over again, Eve, would you have eaten of the tree? I'll guarantee you tonight, if we could see her in heaven and talk to her, she would say, "Not on your life." Matter of fact, I'd like to get a hold of that character that showed up in the garden. I'd like to give him a piece of mind. I'd like to kick him side the head. She'll get her an opportunity one day. Anyway, Genesis chapter number 13, and another individual. As far as we know, Eve was a real nice person. As far as we know, Lot was a real nice person. Had to have been. Think about it. He's a stinking nephew. Abraham's coming up out of Ur of the Chaldees. He's under instructions to leave his house, leave the family. And Lot says, "Uncle Abe, can I go?" And he takes him. Now, if he was a problem child of the family, would Abraham have taken him? No, he said, "You are out of your ever-loving mind. You're Lot." Now, see, we think of Lot, we go, "Oh, that guy." But Abraham took him with him. Lot was a pretty good fellow. I believe he was. Genesis 13, verse number 10. "And Lot lifted up his eyes Better watch out for the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. Those are the things that'll get you saying, I want this, I gotta have that. Oh, give me this, give me that, I gotta have this. And the Lord's saying, no, you don't. Don't you realize you're gonna get this and it's gonna change you? Lot lifted up his eyes and beheld all the plain of Jordan. He saw it all, that it was well watered everywhere before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, even as the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, and now comes into Zoar. Then Lot chose him all the plain of Jordan, and Lot journeyed east, and they separated themselves, the one from the other. Abram dwelled in the land of Canaan, and Lot dwelled in the cities of the plain, and pitched his tent toward Sodom. But the men of Sodom were wicked and sinners before the Lord exceedingly. Yeah, but see, it's so great over there, Lord. I want that. I have to have that. Abram said, well, you know, because I'll take that. If you want this, I'll take that. No. I want that. You sure? Absolutely, positively. Okay, you asked for it. And the next thing, a little incidental little tidbit here. But the men of Sodom were wicked sinners before the Lord exceedingly. See, you got that well-watered land, but what did you have to give in exchange for it? That's exactly what Jesus said. What would it profit a man to gain the whole world, or what would a man give in exchange for his soul? See, Lot exchanged nice, green, fertile cattle land for his family. He cashed in his family. Say, no, he didn't. No. Give me somebody in his family that turned out okay. Only three people came out of Sodom with Lot, and they had to be dragged out. One of them couldn't get too far away before she turned around and turned to a pillar of salt. The other two went all the way. Yes, that's exactly what I wanted to say. You're still looking like you don't get it. Get your head out of the clouds for a second. The other two went all the way with their father. But Lot got what he asked for. Wanted that beautiful land that, oh, we'll be able to make money over there, and that beautiful, oh, cattle can grow like crazy over there. Yes, but you also got Sodom. He calls the wicked Sodomites down there. We don't get into the whole story here, but he says, do not so wickedly, brethren. Brethren? What happened to Lot? I'll tell you what happened to Lot. He got what he asked for. He just got what he asked for. Let me give you one final one here. Luke chapter 15. I believe Eve was a really nice woman. The best. I mean, God made her for Adam. You've heard that expression, God don't make no junk. Well, Eve wasn't a junket. She was a good, a godly, a wonderful woman. The best woman probably ever been made, because God made her. She got tricked. She got tricked by the stinking, low-down, dirty, rotten devil. And she got what she wanted. She just wanted a moment of satisfaction, being able to do something, show God, I'm going to show God. He said, I can't eat of that. He said, I'll surely die. No, I won't. I'll eat of that thing right now, and I'll be like him. Yeah, she got what she asked for. She was a wonderful woman. But wonderful people. You've heard this expression. I know you have. The road to hell is paved with good intentions. I'm sure Eve had some good intentions. I'm sure Lot had some good intentions. But he got what he asked for, and he got the baggage that went along with it. In Luke chapter 15, my final example here, you've heard the story of Mr. Prodigal. Mr. Prodigal. Why, it says there in verse number 11, and he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me, and he divided them his living. Can I Can I say there, I believe the prodigal was a... See, we oftentimes think of him as, what a snotty-nosed little punk. No, because think about it. If he was that way, and he came to his father that way and said, you need to give me that. I want it now. He would have said, get lost. Get lost, you little creep. But he didn't. See, he had to have been a great young man. But he was probably persistent, and he probably had all... I mean, we have to read all of this into a single verse here, but you know, he probably explained, no, Father, if I had that now, I could do this, and I'll do that, and you'll see, I'll be somebody, and I'll make you proud. And he just kept being persistent. And he was probably a nice young man. So whether it was willingly, reluctantly, or whatever, he divided unto him his living. See, he got what he wanted. And not many days after the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. Holy moly, they say. You see how these individuals, Eve and Lot and the prodigal, from what we can see, nice people. But they thought a little more highly of themselves than they ought. And they began to think, you know, I don't think God has my best interest at heart. Sure, he may want to give me these things, but I need it now. I want it now. And they forced the issue. In some cases, who knows if at one point God would have said to Adam and Eve, this thought has never crossed my mind before until just this second. Who knows? Maybe at some point down the road, maybe God would have said to Adam and Eve, you know, you've been very obedient. I told you to stay away from the tree in the midst of the garden, and you've done just that. You know what I'm going to let you do? As your reward, I'm going to go let you eat of that tree. Really, Lord? I mean, think about it. What was God doing? Was that thing really that bad for them to eat? No, I mean, they weren't poisoned. It wasn't like, what's that fairy tale there? Snow White, you know, she ate, she fell down. No, that wasn't that way at all. But God was just testing their willingness to be obedient. He could have chose any tree, but he said, that tree right there, I don't want you to eat of that. Doesn't mean that they never could have eaten of it, but for the time being, don't. No, not right now. But she had to, so all you have to do is tell somebody, you have to wait. Not now, in a little while. Tell a child that. I want this later. See if they're not back in 2 seconds. Now? Kevin, now? Yeah. And you know what happens? Eventually you get to a point where it's like, all right, fine. But you get what you get. Eve got what she was looking for. And she passed it on to Adam, and well, here we are. The whole stinking human race plunged into sin. Thank you. Thank you. But she got what she wanted. And Lot, good old Lot. Yeah. I mean, he was a nice fella. Him and Abraham there, they were both successful, they were doing well. But he looked at that plane over there and he said, oh, you know, and what's that beyond? Well, there's a lot of action going on over there. Now I can have this and that too. Oh yeah, that's what I want. Yeah, well, he got what he wanted. But he got Sodom. Sodom on top of it. You know the rest of the story. Then what did God have to do? See, there was a righteous man down there. Hey, thank God for Abraham. Lot probably would have just been destroyed down there. God is no respecter of persons, you know. He is for salvation. I mean, let me take that back. He's not as far as salvation is concerned. He'll save anybody. But he is, Brother Steve mentioned this morning in the Sunday school hour, he is a respecter of, he's a respecter of his children. You think God thinks more of you as God's children than he does of this wicked old world? Yes, he does. Think he thinks more of his son than he thinks of this wicked old world? He sure does. You think he thinks more of the nation of Israel than he thinks of the United States of America? He sure does. God respects a whole lot of things. But when it comes to salvation, no respect to persons. He'll save anybody. But Lot, a righteous man, God was going to wipe that place out with the righteous man in it. Thank God for Abraham. Lord, would you spare the city? Would you spare the city if I could find 50? 45? 40? 30? 20? 10? It's got to be 10, right? Sorry, no 10. No 10. Sodom, fire and brimstone. But Lot got what he wanted. Got what he asked for. The prodigal. He came to himself. But you know what? I don't know if he ever had a conversation. I love to think in, I don't change the word of God, but I sometimes like to read in between the lines. I think he was all full of hog stuff, and he came crawling out of the hog pen, and he said, what's the matter? What's the matter, Mr. Prodigal? And he said, just thinking about home. Well, where are you from? Oh, you wouldn't believe it. Back at the house, back at the farm, boy, what a place I had. What an existence. I had a whole inheritance. My dad gave it to me. And look at me now. Look at me now. Wow. But how did you end up here? Well, I had all this money, and I begged and pleaded for dad to give it to me, and he gave it to me, and I went out, and I got taken here. Guy came over to me one day and said, psst, hey, buddy. Want to buy a Rolex? And so I started, I bought a Rolex. The next thing I knew, somebody told me it was phony. And then there was a, you ever read about the woman over there in Proverbs, was chapter 8 there? You know, she batted her eyes at me a little. And I, you know, next thing I know, she lifted my wallet. And then, and now I'm, my stomach's growling and all. And I figured, wow, what's that pig eating? Well, that's some corn. I could eat that corn. And here I am down in here. This is awful. And he's telling some guy that story. He said, yeah, but Mr. Prodigal, you got what you asked for. And the Bible says, and he came to himself. Yeah, came to himself. You know, folks, all I'm saying to you tonight in this message is simply this. What is it that you think that you really want? What is it that you think that you really need? What are you begging and pleading God for? Are you willing to, if you say you need it, if you believe that you need it right now, are you willing to take everything that goes along with it? Is there any potential harm or danger in getting what you want now? I guarantee you, Eve and Lot and the prodigal never could see down the road. You know who can see down the road? God.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, fundamental, King James Bible-believing church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You are invited to attend any of our Bible-centered services. Our service times are as follows. Sunday school for all ages at 9:30 a.m. Sunday worship services at 10:30 a.m. and again at 6 p.m. And our midweek prayer